Los Angeles, California. A sad day as throngs gather to mourn the passing of movie star Rita Hayworth. Love goddess of the 40s, dead of Alzheimer's disease at 69. Born Margarita Carmen Cancino, and on the screen in nearly 60 films, she was a brilliant dancer. Incandescent beauty, enchanting and provocative. Perfection and temptation. Brooklyn, New York, 1918. The streets are teeming with children of immigrant families, one of whom would emerge as one of Hollywood's most luminous stars, but at a price.
She talked of her early days, of the work and the hard work, and that she worked so hard as a child. She did talk of that, and with some resentment. And on the other hand, she was also quite proud of it. So I think she had mixed feelings.
Margarita Carmen Cancino was a Broadway baby, and her career got going early. Her Spanish father, Eduardo, and Aunt Elisa held court on the vaudeville stage as the Dancing Cancinos. In 1927, movies are the rage for Mr. and Mrs. America, and Eduardo Cancino sees the writing on the wall. He drives his family from Brooklyn, New York to sunny Hollywood, California. On scenic Sunset Boulevard, he opens a dancing school. 2 years later, it goes bust. But folks, let's face it, very few of us survived when the Great Depression hit. Ambitious and shrewd, Cancino moved the family to Chula Vista near the Mexican border. It was a short drive to the steamy streets of Tijuana or the California docks, where, for the right price, somebody'd take you to the gambling ships anchored 3 miles offshore. Eduardo recast the Dancing Cancinos, and off he would go every night, dragging his new partner, Margarita, 13 years old, the painted girl with the Spanish curl.
She looked 10 years older, which, of course, is the impression they were trying to make. She was such a quiet, reserved girl, and spent most of her free time sitting out on the front porch. And she almost looked frightened. Her eyes widened like a deer. Of course, she never smiled much anyway. She was quite a, I hate to say sad exactly, because she seemed happy enough when she was just sitting around with her brothers. But there was always an expression on her face of, oh, what should I call it? Not wistfulness, I don't really know what to call it, almost sad.
She did not have wonderful, fond, loving feelings toward her father that I remember her ever saying. He demanded blood from her.
Well, we weren't allowed in the house when the parents were home, but we would stand at the windows and watch. They would rehearse in the afternoons. He'd put on this old, Dick Trolla affair, and they'd get out their castanets and rehearse routines. We could hear Mr. Cancino, and he'd yell at Rita, you know, don't do that, don't do that, do it this way. Like a little banty rooster strutting around, and we thought he was kind of mean. She didn't say much, except when her father would criticize her, and then she'd just put her eyes down and say, all right, I'll try. That was about it.
Tinseltown is quiet this 1934 holiday weekend. Hollywood executives and celebrities are in Agua Caliente to enjoy the amenities of this posh Mexican resort. The floor show in the main room is always an attraction, and this weekend features Eduardo and the lovely Margarita, the dancing Cancinos.
I remember going to Caliente with my parents when I was 16, and they announced the dancing Cancinos. And this man came out and danced with this beautiful lady. And I couldn't get over the beautiful lady. And my mother said, "The beautiful lady is old enough to be your mother, Jimmy, for goodness sakes." Later, I just happened to be near these two people, and I realized, no, he wasn't married to this woman. This was his daughter.
Well, when my mother asked Vernon how come that his mother left them alone at night, and he told her, he said, "Well, she has to go and take care of Rita." He said, "My father would get drunk and not take care of her. And also that he would gamble away their paychecks, and she had to go and make sure they got the money because that was their, paid their rent, their food. That was their livelihood." Pardon me. And also, he mentioned that there were men.
When you ask me what is the dark side, I say there's a whole dark side, you see, that I think there is in most of our lives that we keep well hidden. And one day I answer the door, and who's at the door but this attractive gentleman? And he said to me, "I'm Rita's father. I know I should probably have called, but I'd like to see her." And I said, "Well, come on in." He said, "No, I'll wait here." I went back, told Rita that her father's at the door, and she said, "Tell him that I do not want to see him." I stood there and I said, "I can't tell him that. You tell him that." She said, "Tell him I do not want to see him." And I knew her now well enough to know that was that. So I told him.
I think the trauma in my mother's childhood was the fact that she had to work. She was forced to work. It was something that there was no choice. She had no choice. She didn't have a normal childhood. I mean, how could she when she was dancing, training, performing? There was no time for the fun things of childhood. She wasn't allowed to have that. And I think, yes, she was robbed.
We're back in Agua Caliente, Mexico, folks, which has just added another chapter to the American dream of rags to riches. Movie executive Winfield Sheehan was here this weekend to offer 16-year-old Margarita Cancino a six-month contract with Fox Pictures. Sheehan said her first picture will be the Spencer Tracy vehicle, Dante's Inferno. You'll do well to keep an eye on this one, folks. She's going places. On the town in Tinseltown, folks, Ciro's, the Players Club, and the Macambo, where we chatted with reputed Texas oil man Eddie Judson. On his arm was the dancing doll from Dante's Inferno, Rita Cancino. Since she was dropped from Fox, the shadowy Judson says he's been getting Rita lots of small parts in lots of small movies to get the attention of lots of big producers.
According to Barker, he wants Welles to get him a girl to act as entertainer in his saloon and to work with the gang.
It looks like a job for me. What am I to do?
Just this. It's up to you to find out how they operate.
Thank you. Eddie Judson, in order to use a cliche expression, would leave no stone unturned to have his wife become successful. And if that meant that he had to close his eyes while she went to bed with a film executive or an important male star, I believe that he would do it. I never saw him put his arms around her and kiss her. They seemed to have a business relationship. And he brought me in as one of the people who conceivably could help. Part of the campaign was that we wanted to make sure that people knew who she was and that people became aware and saw her. You can't do that if the woman stays home every night. So they would go out and I would alert the photographers ahead of time that Rita Hayworth and Eddie Judson were going to be at Ciro's at 11 o'clock this evening. Be sure to take their pictures.
The stars were blinding at Ciro's last night, folks, and the brightest of all were Gable and Lombard, America's favorite couple. On the dance floor, all eyes were on the fiery Latin bombshell newcomer, Rita Cancino.
The result of all this was that in 4 to 6 weeks, Rita Hayworth, this unknown actress, was on the cover of Look magazine, and this was, in my opinion, the launch of the press career, at least, of Rita Hayworth.
Harry Cohn may be the most feared mogul in Hollywood, but he sure has an eye for the ladies of 1937. Columbia has signed starlet Rita Cancino to a 7-year deal. Looks like Eddie Judson's been keeping her busy, but she's sure grateful. Yesterday, they eloped to Yuma, Arizona. The groom is 44, the bride, 19.
I first met Rita on the set of the first picture that I made there. She was part of my life. And I liked her, by the way. I liked Rita. There was a nice, gentle quality about that woman. Something a little sad, too, if I think back. I don't know if she was ever able to find herself. Someone was always guiding her, weren't they? I mean, the father, and then Harry Cohn, and then a husband here and there. Grooming was constant. When you weren't shooting a picture, you were making still pictures. If not, you were out on the beach in a bathing suit doing leg art. All that was part of it. Part of it just never stopped. Considered property, chattels, yes.
It's all just a wonderful trick of fate or luck of fate that a person comes out with the absolute physiognomy that's right for the camera. That's what Rita had. That's the least of what she had, you know. It wasn't her, it was just great luck. You know, had she been homely or not particularly attractive, we wouldn't be sitting and talking about her. A great deal of what happened to Rita came as a result of a face that and a body that men wanted to own.
People often ask me my concept of the most beautiful woman in the films. I constantly say Rita Hayworth had a very good palette to start your work with. There was a slight imperfection. And the only one I could ever find in her face, her one of her eye was a little smaller than the other. So it's like saying she has lovely legs, especially the right one. You know, I mean, it's that kind of a... she did have that low forehead, of course, and electrolysis was suggested. Before, it was just jet black hair and a low hairline, and he was there every minute, and he directed the whole operation.
Stunning redhead Rita Hayworth was at Ciro's last night. Don't know the name? She used to be raven-haired Rita Cancino. Eddie Judson is thrilled with his protege's new look and told reporters he would be continuing to search for... There's a lot of excitement on the Columbia lot these days, folks. Rita Hayworth's performance in Only Angels Have Wings has sent hearts a-quivering from Seattle to Savannah. Harry Cohn may finally have that hot tamale he's been searching for. The Streetwise studio chief sure isn't wasting any time. Wags report he's huddling with Daryl Zanuck, who fired Rita from Fox only 4 years ago, about a one-picture loan-out deal that could bring Hayworth back to her old studio in triumph. There's a new star in the Hollywood firmament, and look out, America. Flame-haired Rita Hayworth's performance in Blood and Sand has redefined the word temptress. This is the breakthrough picture Eddie Judson's been waiting for. Looks like Harry Cohn's got himself a handful.
What set her apart from all the other actresses was this parallel of her incredible sensitivity and helplessness and vulnerability, and yet at the same time there would be this underlining strength and almost hardness that she could in a flash and in a moment turn into somebody who was quite strong and almost cool.
In spite of this beauty that we talk about and this magic on the screen, I'll bet you that it made her feel always inferior, too. I'll bet you, because when you have to try to please somebody all the time, you're going to feel inadequate. They're always wanting you to do more, to be better than you are. I mean, there's no way you can finally please. You're always saying, did I do all right? Am I okay?
C'est magnifique. That's what the French call the lovely Rita Hayworth, and that's only the beginning. Anywhere they love movies, they love the love goddess. But don't worry, Mr. and Mrs. America, our Rita's not going anywhere. She's still the same simple Brooklyn gal who won our hearts only a few movies ago.
Well, one evening, she called me, said, come on over, said, as she would do just casually. And I said, fine, I'll come over. And so I rang the doorbell, she came to the door, and she opened the door, and she didn't say a word, and she had castanets, and then she started to click them, you know, and just dance around and down around the room, and I said, that's wonderful. She didn't say a thing, she just kept dancing, and she danced for about 4 or 5 minutes. Finally, she said, hello, sit down, you know, but... She was like that, you know, just a little girl playing.
Tommy, let's have the second 24 bars. Ready? One and two and.
Fred Astaire loved the way Rita danced. He would call me. I wasn't on the picture, but he'd call me. I said, "Oh," I said, "that Hayworth, she's so great. Said she's, it's a pleasure to work with her, you know." And he used to tell me, "You used to kid her, you know." And he would put his hands in ice water, and she had a midriff on, and he would finally say, "Rita, let's try this step," and he'd put his cold hand on his midriff, and she would scream.
December 7th, 1941, America goes to war, but Joe and Johnny Dogface have company. Fred Astaire's new partner, the incomparable Rita Hayworth, is on the cover of this month's Life magazine. And boy, GIs from the Coral Sea to Cairo just can't get enough of her. The fan letters keep pouring in. Also from Tinseltown, the opening of Orson Welles' Citizen Kane. The boy genius from the Mercury Theater's been bragging he's going to woo and marry the lovely Rita. Seems far-fetched to me, folks, but watch out. What Orson wants, Orson usually gets.
We were very close and very good friends, and lasted all through all of her husbands. Knew them all. Some I liked, some I didn't like. Some were good for her, most of them were bad for
her. Eddie Judson sort of used her, too, because I heard that he confiscated her salary at Fox, and she had no money. And she used to come to my house with her secretary, Pat, and she'd say, "Have you got anything to eat?" I said, "Sure, come over."
Flash! The mastiest divorce of the year has got to be Rita Hayworth's from her husband of 5 years, Eddie Judson. Rita showed up in court with her mother, Volga Cancino, but it didn't help. This May-December wedding ended with a bang when Rita, who claims she's broke, was ordered to pay Judson. Score one for the bad guys. But Rita's bouncing back. She's been seen on the arm of the ever-persistent Orson Welles.
Dreams were never lovelier. Pardon me if I stare. Down the sky the moonbeams fly to light your face. I can only say they chose the proper place. You were never lovelier, and to coin a new phrase, was never luckier in my palmiest days. Make a note and you can quote me honor bright. You were never lovelier than you are tonight.
He gave her things of interest. She became politically involved and met different strata of people, and found that there was another life other than the film business.
And good news for the Orson Welles family. Baby Rebecca, born December 17th, 1944, and mom and daughter are doing just fine. Our Rita still has time for her special fans, though. The undisputed pinup queen of World War II is working her heart out to keep our boys' spirits up. Atta girl, Rita. This note, two stars are colliding over earthquake-prone Los Angeles. Tinseltown's bad boy, Orson Welles, has been seen nightclubbing about town, while his lovely Rita and baby Rebecca are pining at home. Tongues are wagging that a separation is imminent.
She respected Orson, felt that he was an incredible genius, talked of him that way, talked of his genius. He was dominant in her life, and he needed to be protected and to be cared for and to have that feeling of security. And after a while, she would become quite disappointed.
Nobody goes through life without some problems, but she would not know it. She never brought it to work. When I was on the lot, guys came up to me that I had never met. Grips, carpenters, lighting guys, prop men. And they would come up and they'd say, "You won't remember, so I'm going to give you this note." I came with about 50 notes from guys on the lot that hadn't seen Rita for years but had worked with her in pictures, all saying, "Rita, hey, love, Pete, whatever." These notes, one after another, I had a whole envelope of them. That is the kind of lady. Now, I don't know anybody else that I've ever heard anything like that happen. And to me, that's the greatest tribute she could possibly get.
After the war, I'd come back after I'd been away a long time. I was in the Marine Corps. And it was the second picture I did after I came back, and I guess that's when I loved her very deeply at that time. So Gilda would be my favorite. It's a strange relationship, hate-love-hate relationship. But as we discussed it right here, we discussed that that's the most exciting kind of a love, you know, on that razor's edge.
Gilda, are you decent?
Me? Sure, I'm decent.
Put the blame on me, boy. Put the blame on me. Did a dance called the Hitchy Coo. That's the thing that slew my groove. Put the blame on me, boys. Put the blame on me.
It's the Phenom of 1946. If you thought Rita Hayworth was a big star before, folks, well, now you ought to call her superstar. You want to know how super? From now on, when men's minds dwell on titillating temptation, only one name will be on their lips, Gilda.
It's very possible that men saw my mother as Gilda and not as Rita Hayworth. Did they have as many interviews as they do today on television? No, they didn't. So maybe they couldn't see the real person. And there was such hype from the studios.
Flash, Harry Cohn has scored the coup of his storied career. Word has it that Cohn has rescued Orson Welles' troubled European production in exchange for directing a new movie for Columbia. And who's starring in it? None other than Orson's estranged wife, the love goddess herself. Word has it that Welles is rewriting the script and redesigning Rita. Is Cohn happy? Nobody's asking. What the whole country wants to know is, do all rich women play games like this?
Killing you is killing myself. It's the same thing. But you know, I'm pretty tired of both of us.
Oh, Michael. I'm afraid. Michael. Come back here. Michael! Please! I don't want to die! I don't want to die!
There's stunning news from Hollywood tonight. At the height of her fame and popularity, superstar Rita Hayworth, love goddess of the 40s, has made a fateful decision.
I came into makeup and she was in the chair, I remember it. And I don't know what, I mean, because I was standing behind her. I remember those hands going. And she said, I guess she was going to Europe. She said, I'm not going to live my entire life on a soundstage.
Exhausted, overworked, and overwrought by her troubled marriage to Orson Welles, our Rita has decided to take her first vacation in years, sailing this morning for Europe. She wouldn't say when she'd return. Exclusive from the French Riviera, Rita Hayworth may be off the screen, but she's still on the news after attending a lavish ball hosted by Elsa Maxwell, doyenne of the society set. And listen to this. Amid the Marquesas and Earls, Rita has found a prince, Ali Khan, international playboy and sportsman, son of the fabulously wealthy Aga Khan, spiritual leader of the Ismaili Muslim sect. It seems Rita and the prince are truly smitten with each other. Folks, this could be the romance of the century.
My mother was a very concerned mother. She would talk to me of my music, and she cared very much as to where we were going, what time we were being dropped off. I mean, she was always on top of the situation. We were very much just very chummy, very, very close. My mother and father's relationship was incredibly romantic. They had a very strong bond. She entered into his world, which was a magical, unreal world to her, since she was so much more down to earth and had worked in Tijuana and had a totally different life.
If you saw a photograph of a woman getting off of an airplane with Ali Khan, one of the richest men in the world, coming down some steps and people flinging flowers at her feet and her dress being kissed and everybody backing away, the impression most of us would get is, isn't that great? Isn't that a wonderful life? When in fact what's going through that person's mind is, when am I going to get in the car? When am I going to get away from this? This is embarrassing me or angering me or frightening me, more likely frightening for Rita. She told me that she didn't like to go, as to quote her, I didn't want to go no place where they kissed the hem of my dress.
I think it was very difficult for my mother to be married to Prince Ali Khan, to be the princess. She was very much an all-American girl, and there were just certain codes and rules that were so foreign to her. Also, he adored women. Certainly, I can't remember this because I was a child, but from what I've heard and what I've read, and this was something that my mother couldn't understand or deal with.
Flash, Chateau Lioraison, France. Things aren't too happy in Never Never Land. Ali Khan's lavish home on the Mediterranean stands silent and alone. Princess Rita, with her daughters in tow, has fled. Arriving in New York Harbor, she addresses her fans and the press. We bring you these exclusive pictures.
I'm thrilled to be back home again, and I'm most grateful for the very warm reception that you all have given me. And, of course, I'm most anxious for my children to see America. And, you know, the first thing I'm going to do is go out and get a hot dog. I can't wait.
And when you finish that hot dog, Rita, Hollywood is waiting. It's been a long 3 years.
She had a commitment at Columbia, if I'm not mistaken, that Cohen was absolutely holding her to, having a princess. It was a plus for Harry Cohen, and he certainly wasn't going to let her go.
She told me that she had $330,000 when she married him, and when she came back, she was broke. Her contract was in abeyance for the 3 years she was married to Ali Khan. But when she came back, all she did was walk into Columbia and said, I'm back, and they had to put her back on salary because her contract wasn't broken. She couldn't work anyplace else, by the way. The first meeting was arranged by Harry Cohn. He told her that I was going to direct her next picture. She said very little at that first meeting, seemed very shy and a little bit frightened, I think, at the approach of doing a picture. She hadn't done anything in several years. And afterwards, he said to me, now, I want to tell you, he said, she's very good on reacting. And he said, give the other people the dialogue, but when you get to her, he says, just get her reaction. He says, she's a great reactionary type. So I said, okay, I'll try to remember that.
Steve, the things you believe about me, they're not true.
Forget it. You don't have to count to me for anything.
But I want to.
Why didn't you tell me about the crest, about Fabian, about everything? What is it between you and him?
There's nothing between us.
Is that why he looks at you the way he does? Like he can't wait to get his arms around you?
I can't help how he looks at me. But his arms have never been around me. Nobody's arms. Not for a long time.
I think the thing that I remember particularly about her was one night I was having dinner with her and the writer. And the writer left early, went back to the office to work. I promised to join him a little later. And we talked. She told me a little bit about experience with living with Ali, when she was married to Ali Khan, etc. And at one point, after about a half hour, I said, Rita, honey, I'd like to talk to you more, but I better get back to the office and help Jimmy on the script. And she looked at me and said, you're bored with me, aren't you? And I said, no, no, of course not. And she said, yeah, she said, I know. She said, I can always get a man, but I can't keep him.
After a year of legal wrangling, Prince Ali Khan is back in Hollywood to try and smooth over his differences with his estranged wife. The proud Rita has refused to take a dime from Ali, but she has insisted on a substantial trust fund for the tiny princess Yasmin. Is a reconciliation in the works? Don't bet on it, folks. It looks like the romance of the century is going to be the divorce of the decade.
She made a lot of money, and it was all taken from her. Beginning with Judson and going forward from there. She took not a penny from Prince Ali Khan. She got nothing in that divorce settlement. So her earnings as an actress, the living is high, and her financial situation towards the end wasn't that sensational.
Have you plans for a picture in the immediate future? Do you want to make another film?
I'd love to make another film.
Why did you leave Honolulu?
Guess I wanted a change. Got a job waiting for me in New Caledonia.
You wanted a change. I'll tell you why.
Listen, I don't know why I'm getting all this attention.
You're going to New Caledonia to carry on your trade.
I don't know what you're talking about.
I'm talking about why you had to leave Honolulu. You're a prostitute.
What? Who do you think you are calling me names? You're a dirty, rotten liar.
I want to give you a chance to redeem yourself.
Where do you get off with that kind of talk?
A chance to find salvation before it's too late.
You're no priest or missionary. You try to act like one, but the collar don't fit.
Insulting me won't help you.
I've listened to you all I'm going to. Now you listen to me. You lay off, or I'll show you what it means when I start to get mad. How do you like that double-talking, no-good louse? Adding me a line like that, if he starts that guff again, I'll...
It was difficult for my mother to go through the aging process. She was very concerned about her looks, and she was mad about makeup and creams, and would in fact tell me that I'd always have to take care of my skin and make sure that I put cream on my face and to avoid the wrinkles. She had a difficult time aging. I think it was hard for her.
The running feud between Rita Hayworth and Harry Cohn is heating up again on the set of Pal Joey. Cohn has brought in sultry starlet Kim Novak to co-star opposite Rita and Frank Sinatra. And it's no secret he wants the boffo blonde to bloom as the new love goddess.
She knew where it was coming from. She knew that it was Harry Cohn and not me. She was always charming and gracious. Remember when I went, actually, I think I was going to a fitting, and she appeared in a most gorgeous black leather tight fitted suit and just looked absolutely gorgeous. And I thought, God, I'd die to look like that. She was so beautiful and so spectacular. Whatever she was feeling inside, because I knew what pressure she was under from Harry Cohn, she wasn't about to let anybody know something was getting to her.
There are certain needs, maybe at the time in her life, she needed affection and attention more so than any other time. And then at that point, you're more vulnerable because you need the affection and you need the love that you look to love in a human being that maybe isn't the most desirable, such as Dick Hames.
Romance in Nevada, as screen star Rita Hayworth ties the knot with singer Dick Hames in Las Vegas. The bride's two daughters, Yasmin, 3, and Rebecca, 8, appear to enjoy the brief civil ceremony. It's marriage number 4 for bride and groom. Each vows this one is for keeps.
I wasn't crazy about him. Well, I think he had a tendency towards alcohol, and he just didn't have a caring quality about him. Really was not much of a relationship that I can remember. I tried to stay away as much as possible and not get involved with him.
Dick Hames' fading singing career doesn't bode well for his new bride. Dick has reportedly insisted the lovely Rita, who draws crowds wherever she goes, leave the kids behind and appear at his far-flung club dates. It's fine to stand by your man, Rita, but maybe you should sit this one out.
I don't understand how she could fall into those things. She's intelligent enough. But anything he wanted, she did. She appeared at the immigration hearings, everything for him. Anything for Dick Hames at that point.
I think if a man loved her, she existed. It's that simple for her. If she was loved and looked after and cared for, she existed. And you know how I mean that. In her deepest sense of herself, she did not exist unless it was in the arms of, the face of, the eyes of, or at some time, and certainly on a lot of occasions, the brutality of a man.
There are people who can cope with the ups and rather mostly the downs in life, and she was really not strong enough to deal with the blows.
The length of time consumed was because Judge Smythe, very properly in our opinion, wanted to examine Mrs. Hames as to her competency and fitness to act as the mother and guardian of her children. And in listening to the statements made for and on behalf of Prince Ali Khan, that the custody of Yasmin should be with Rita Hayworth.
Mother had a drinking problem. When something would be so difficult for her, she didn't have a platform underneath her to support her. She didn't ever build her ego and her self-esteem, I think. I think that was essentially was missing, and therefore it would throw her, and then she'd become so upset she'd go to the bottle.
More bad news for Mr. and Mrs. Hames. Columbia Pictures has filed a breach of contract suit against Rita Hayworth for walking off a movie set. This uncharacteristic behavior for someone known for her professionalism. Claiming that Dick Hames is interfering in what should be a simple negotiation over visitation rights, Prince Ali Khan has asked the courts to extend its jurisdiction over his daughter Yasmin. Singer Dick Hames' career continues to slide downhill, despite Rita Hayworth's appearances at his nightclub engagements. Rita continues to insist that nothing is wrong, and despite new evidence to the contrary, she is flying to Las Vegas this week to be with her husband during his appearance.
She wanted that quality of a simple man to be a simple life, but she was too far gone. She was too big a star and too famous to get into that simple life.
Neighbors report that Rita and Dick Hames had a drunken screaming match on the front lawn of their Malibu home the other night. It's the final blow for Mr. and Mrs. Dick Hames. After being slugged by her singer husband in public, Rita has filed for divorce, claiming mental and physical cruelty. Her lawyer, Leonard... Prince Ali Khan is dead. 1 week after visiting his daughter Yasmin and ex-wife Rita Hayworth, the 44-year-old diplomat was killed in a high-speed...
I'm no good. I'm all worn out. I've been passed from hand to hand.
I've had to submit to things that nice young American boys couldn't conceive of in their wildest nightmares. I've lived among the ruins. Armies have marched over me. Armies. I've been debased. I look in the mirror and I say, what a lie. At the first glance, the face looks like the face of a human being.
There was no push from Rita. It just came out. She had had failed relationships, you know, one after another, already in her life. In other words, I think that it was the kind of thing that, which basically for an actor he loves, it's a bit delicious when you read a good scene as the character who's in it, and you, the actor, you get through reading it and say, oh boy, I've been there. I know, I don't have to wonder. How am I going to play this? I've been there. I know.
My mother's marriage to James Hill was, I think, at first a wonderful, supportive, loving relationship, and then it, over a period of time, turned into almost a sort of alcoholic and drinking partnership.
Producer Jim Hill, partner of Harold Hecht and Burt Lancaster, has cast his new bride in the screen version of Terence Rattigan's stage play, Separate Tables. With the likes of Lancaster, David Niven, and Deborah Carr in the cast, this is quite a stretch for the lovely Rita. Can she make the transition to serious character roles? Does America want her to?
I was delighted because I was so tired of seeing her playing things that really, she had so much more talent than anybody had exposed up until then.
Please don't be angry with me. I had to see you. I was desperate to
see
you.
What for? Why? To help me? You wouldn't think of telling me the truth. No, you had to have your conquest, your unconditional surrender. And if you could do it by lying and cheating, so much
better. All right. I knew you were going to get married, but I should have said so from the beginning, but I still have some pride left.
Pride? Yes. I can see the makeup now, all right. The lines that weren't there before. The beginning. Soon there'll be more and more, and then one day this face will begin to decay, and there'll be nothing left to make a man grovel, to make him want to...
Why don't you?
She began to unwind. These strange things would happen.
It must have been a restaurant, because I remember her at a booth. Yes, I saw her and came across to her. I don't know where it was. And said hello. It was exciting to, my God, there's Rita. And went over to say hello, and it was just, nothing happened.
Ann Miller and myself were invited to a house. And so in the middle of the dinner, she suddenly said, I don't like either of you. Get out. Just like that. You know? And Ann sort of, you know, smoothed it over. And so we left. A little later, she called me up and said, well, hello, honey. How are you? You know, what's new? She had forgotten all about it.
She would become forgetful. She would hallucinate in the house, think that she would hear voices outside in the middle of the night, and would call the police, and the Beverly Hills police would come in the middle of the night, and we'd look around the house, and there would be no one. And she did this quite often.
By the time we got to our picture, she was having trouble memorizing, so everything had to be written on cue cards for her. And she couldn't retain a line past the cue of it.
Why are you here?
Because God is here.
That man is not God. I've come to kill him.
Then kill me too.
There was a man laying at her feet off camera, and I would ask her the question, and the man would give her her line, and then she'd say her line, because she couldn't retain it. It took us 3 or 4 hours to get that scene.
There's a sad note in the news tonight, folks. Rita Hayworth, after several incidents of bizarre public behavior, has been committed to Hogue Memorial Hospital in Newport Beach. What's gone wrong with the former love goddess of the 40s? No one seems to know.
She was really a broken person. She was just totally exposed and helpless, totally, totally helpless. And looking to me for support and for help. I just understood her to have a drinking problem, and that obviously had a psychological effect. And at the time, I didn't know it was Alzheimer's.
They had transferred her from the psychiatric ward to a regular bedded room. And while I was there, the phone rang. It was Yazzie from New York saying, "You're coming to New York. I'm sending you some clothes. You're going to be nice, and it'll be great for you." She hung up the phone, and she was a different woman. I mean, her face just blossomed, you know, and it was the old Rita that I knew. I mean, it was all of the sanity came back, and she knew where she was and everything. She was going, you know, to New York. And I thought to myself, I didn't know Yazzie as a woman. I knew her as a little girl. And I thought, God, what a wonderful thing to have that child, you know, that is now going to take care of her mother.
It was natural for me. Maybe it's not natural for other children, other people to do. It was natural for me. It wasn't something that I had to make a conscious decision. Am I going to do this? Or, you know, what will the consequences be if I do this? It was just something that I did spontaneously. It was a normal thing for me to do.
On every occasion when I came to New York, I would always call and see Rita, and I watched her sinking from this Alzheimer's problem. And she went by private jet from Los Angeles to New York. And at that time, she barely had an understanding of the people around her and so on. With each visit in New York, I could see her condition become worse and worse.
If you're lucky as you get older, you begin to drop a lot of the things you need to keep away from yourself, and you find yourself probably around the time that Rita would have blessedly begun to find her true self, this disease got in the way.
She would pace the room. She would shuffle her feet and pace the rooms. And wring her hands. She would stop and look in the mirror and talk to herself in a language that was totally strange. It was really a mumble jumble of words, something that I couldn't understand that perhaps she could understand. The most painful thing for me was that I felt helpless to see her lose the ability to communicate, to have that loss of communication. I just felt so terrible, really miserable, very painful, to see her so helpless.
Pandit Nehru of India gave me a rose one time, and he said, "I want you to look at that rose and think about it and keep it for a long time, and I'll see you again." And he did see me the next year. He said, "What did you think?" And I said, "I kept seeing the rose." And he says, "Even when the petals were falling off, I still saw that beautiful rose." He says, "That's the whole point I'm making, Glenn." He says, "If you have this beautiful rose, and if you love that rose, truly, even though the petals fall off and it withers up, you still see the beautiful rose. You still see that which you loved."
Every day was, you know, I thought, well, is it today? You know, I'd worry. I was always worried about whether she was going to die. I just lived with it, really. K- guess you become used to it in a way. And when she did die, the nurse had told me she died very peacefully. She was changing her in her bed. And she had rolled her from her back to her side to change her. And at that moment, my mother took a sigh and died.
Los Angeles, California. Yesterday was a sad day for millions of people worldwide as tearful throngs gathered to mourn the passing of movie star Rita Hayworth, dead of Alzheimer's disease at 69. There are no pearls of wisdom for such a day, folks. Only a gentle tear for a gentle lady, finally embracing the peace she had always sought. Thank you, Margarita. Goodbye, and Godspeed.